So what you're doing is you're watching a live taping of the Sirius radio show that Joe and I do regularly called Stanford Legal, and it airs on Sunday mornings, and then sometime some other stuff as well. We've done some live Facebook Lives, right?
And you can get it. You can get it afterwards. You don't have to get up at 7 a.m. on Sunday to listen to it.
Yeah.
Though I know most of you will from now on.
And it's also on the Stanford app somehow, right?
There's a Stanford radio website, and you can also get it on iTunes. So, yeah. Check it out.
Because we've interviewed a lot of faculty here by now, so if you're thinking one faculty's expertise is particularly interesting to you, you can check out to see if we interviewed them.
And today we're doing our third student?
Yeah, because we
did Sean Rosenberg, and we did somebody else. Oh, no, former student, Steve Seiger.
So. You ready?
Yeah.
Let's do it.
Welcome to Stanford Legal, where we look at the cases, questions, conflicts, and legal stories that affect us all every day. I'm Pam Karlan, along with Joe Bankman.
It's nice to be here, Pam. And this is a special podcast because we're doing this live in front of admitted students for Stanford Law School. And we know each year we have fantastic students. Some prospective students are in our audience now. And this is a show about a fantastic student who's already here, Matt Ball. Matt's a third-year law student here and a former captain in the U.S. Army who served in Afghanistan. He's now a company commander in the reserves. He's volunteered with the International Refugee Assistance Project. And I know, Pam, he's worked in your Supreme Court litigation clinic.
Yes, he has. And, you know, one of the things is I think for a lot of students, we have clinic boot camp, and people talk about how hard law school is. But I think for you, Matt, law school has been a little bit of a walk in the park compared to what you did before law school. And we also have with us today Qismat Amin, who has had an even more extraordinary story in some ways. And we're just so grateful to both of you for coming to share your stories with us.
And I'm going to start with the stories. And Matt, I'm going to ask you to describe where and when you first met Qismat.
Sure. So first, thanks for having us both on. It's a pleasure and an honor. So I first met Qismat in late 2010. My first deployment to Afghanistan was in sort of August 2010 to August 2011. And it was to sort of a remote part of eastern Afghanistan, right on the Afghan-Pakistan border, called Nangarhar. And Qismat was my interpreter. We had basically, we were sent there to this sort of area where there had been a pretty low presence for U.S. soldiers prior. This was part of the Afghan surge. And so it was sort of like an expeditionary mission for us. And there were several districts when we arrived that were in sort of in de facto Taliban control. And our mission when we got there was essentially to retake them and in the course of the year establish some sort of presence, transfer sort of power over to the Afghan government, and sort of be able to, you know, leave these districts, you know, with sort of a government in place. So a pretty daunting task, and one that's really hard to do without some sort of conduit to the people. So that's what Qismat was for me. I don't actually remember specifically, like, you know, exactly when we met, but we spent almost every day together doing sort of a number of things, but that's sort of when and where it began.
And Qismat, how did you find yourself as a translator for the U.S. Army?
Oh, it's a good question, actually. So that was in 2010, and yeah, I was recently graduating from high school, and I was thinking about, like, I need to do something, and I said that before, I mean, in my many shows and stuff, like, I've done that a lot before, but my story's not that famous, but thank you for making it so famous. Yeah, so in 2010, I was graduating from high school, and then, like, I was already fascinated by the U.S. military, to be honest. When I was a kid, I was like, wow, these guys are amazing, you know, and the trucks and the military, you know, because, like, when you were a kid, you like movies, you know, you like actions and stuff. So, but also, at the same time, we were going through some like economic problems in the family that I wanted, like, okay, somebody needs to, like, work, you know, work for the family. And I was already, like, kind of in love with the U.S. military. I was like, yeah, let's do it. So, yeah, in 2010, I went through, like, a ticket test, and then had a few other tests, and then I qualified and then start working for the military.
Had you taken English in high school? Is that how you...
No, I went to an English course. So it took me like a year to learn language, but I was not as fluent as I am right now. But yeah, then I worked for the military.
And Matt, tell us a little bit about your background. How did you end up in Afghanistan? What made you decide to go into the Army?
Yeah, sure. So there were sort of a number of factors, but when I graduated college, I was sort of drifting towards... New York, like vaguely towards finance, and I was sort of at the time realizing that that wasn't what I wanted to do.
Oh, the horror.
But, I think for me, sort of after college, as I started to think about what I wanted to do, I was sort of following the path of least resistance at the time. But I had taken Arabic a lot in college. I had studied abroad in Yemen and in Egypt. I wrote sort of a senior thesis at the time on Iraq, and I think it started to bother me a little bit that I was writing on something in a university setting. This was in 2008, so sort of surrounded by a lot of anti-war protest, but I didn't know a single person who was personally involved in the Iraq war. And so I think that I started feeling this creeping sense of responsibility and a sense that if I was sort of going to have the privilege to do the things that I was doing and write about things and think about things, that it was sort of incumbent on me to serve and to take part. So I sort of signed up right after I graduated. Like, very ironically, I joined the Army and assumed, like, with Arabic that I would be sent to Iraq. Instead, I went to Afghanistan three times. I think that's one side. I think the other side is I did have this sense, sort of contrasting with doing finance or a number of things you do after you graduate. I did have this sense that I wanted to do something adventurous when I was in my 20s. I wanted something that was sort of personally challenging on a number of levels. So that was a big motivator. And I think in that respect, I very much got what I wanted and much more. I mean, I was kind of thrown into, with Qismat, just this like really, really difficult situation and hard problem set that was, we've sort of trusted really young leaders, like 23, 24-year-olds, to solve sort of like graduate-level, sociological problems in foreign countries while sort of, receiving and returning fire. So that challenge, which was a big part of, I think, why I signed up, was like I said, I definitely got what I bargained for.
Can you tell me about, like, a memorable day for the two of you, Qismat?
A memorable day? Okay, so I mean, honestly, like, every day was a memorable day, but I remember that, probably Matt remember not, that we went to a place called Sherzad, and we stayed on top of the hill like for almost 3 days. And I remember that I always tell Matt that you had that green, the blue notebook. Yeah, so we were waking up early in the morning and just we were sitting in the truck. It was kind of like a good time. It was pretty cold, and we were just sitting in the truck on top of the hill. And Matt was taking note, and I remember you had a very kind of small camera. Yeah, you had a camera, and yeah, we were talking about a lot of things, and I remember that we even talked about America too, because I had no idea how America looks like, to be honest. Like, I was just thinking about America, just like America will look exactly how it looks in the movies, how the culture is and everything. But yeah, every day was really, really, I mean, every day was an amazing day, but we talked a lot every day, just like talk about different things. Yeah. Even talk about work, like I was kind of like working with him all the time, and every time when there was something like really special, we were talking to Matt. So like every day was special, to be honest. Like, I don't remember.
So that was actually, I do remember that. That was actually Christmas. Yeah. So I remember this because we were like freezing cold in a truck. Yeah. Those districts that I talked about earlier that we were sort of sent there to take over, that was like the eve of the invasion, basically. And so we spent 3 days like in this truck looking out over this district. Mm-hmm. And it just so happened to be Christmas. And I remember waking up and like, every American soldier was like, really, this is how we're spending Christmas. But yeah, Kevin and I were, talking about America.
This is Stanford Legal. And today we're talking with Matt Ball and Qismat Amin about their time in Afghanistan and their time in the United States.
Qismat and Matt, you've talked to us about sharing personal stories together on a Christmas day overlooking a hill. How about times when we think of wartime as you're scared to death and there are bad guys around and Matt say you're relying on Qismat to save your butt? Is that another kind of set of memories that we can jog?
Yeah, so we do. I mean, you know, we were in situations where things got sort of kinetic, as we say, where we were sort of under indirect fire, direct fire. I think the times that I actually remember more concretely, though, when Qismat sort of was the most valuable, or really, like you said, say my butt was, we did a lot of engagement, a lot of sitting down with tribal elders, these people who really were like the power centers in the villages where they came from. And all the time there would be this dynamic where we would just be getting hit really, really hard, mostly by IEDs. And so we had this sense that, you know, in the village, the people that are emplacing these explosives, the people who are attacking us, there had to be some knowledge of who these people were from, you know, sort of these power brokers. And then I think from their perspective, they saw us as coming in with a ton of resources, a ton of money, but they weren't receiving the development that they wanted. And so you would have a lot of really frustrating encounters where all we wanted to do was, you know, yell at these people to say, like, you have to stop blowing us up. Like, we keep getting, you know, we keep losing soldiers. This has to stop. They would be yelling at us saying, you're the Americans. You came in. We thought our roads would be paved. They're not paved. And Qismat would position himself in the middle of that and do much more than just sort of translating from English to Pashto, sort of calm both sides down and say, you know, to the Americans, listen, you know, this is the perspective that these people have. This is what you need to tell them. This is what they want to hear. This is where they're coming from. And then I think turn around to the Afghans and say, they're on your side. They want to help you. I know it seems like it's really easy, you know, for them to come in and change things completely, but these are some of the constraints that they face. So the biggest times that he, you know, I think was sort of went above and beyond as an interpreter was really as a mediator between two very much conflicting sides.
So you finished up, I guess, your third deployment in Afghanistan and came back here to start law school. Qismat, how did you decide that you needed to leave Afghanistan?
Well, I mean, at the beginning, to be honest, when I started working for the U.S. military, like, I would never think about going to America, to be honest, because there was, like, literally nothing. Like, you know, there was no program. There was no sort of, like, visa process that you could come to America and live in America. But in 2010, I remember that some of my buddies told me that there's a special immigrant visa program for Afghan interpreters. Like, if you have worked for the U.S. military for a year and you have, like, certain documents and stuff, so you can qualify and go to U.S., so to be honest, I was like, well, I don't believe in that my buddies were telling me, like, even if you get a letter from just like a private, like a soldier, you'll be still qualified and be able to get the visa. I was like, well, I don't believe in that. But there was another program. It's called exactly same visa process. They call the CAMA approval, like chief of mission visa process. So the requirement for that was that you have to have a general letter. A letter from the U.S. general, and so I talked to Colonel Johnson, who's the boss for everybody. So I talked to him. I was like, "Well, can you help me with the letter from to get me a letter from general?" And I told him that in a meeting. It was kind of funny. He was like, "Oh, the general's not even ready to give me a letter. He's going to give you a letter." I was like, "Well, try it." So, but finally, I got a letter from one of the three-star general, and who was the NATO commander in Afghanistan like a year ago, General Campbell. I got a letter from him, and everybody was like, whoa, you're going to go to America for sure. For sure you're going to go to America. I was like, wow. And I remember that one of my buddies, he's a cat too. He lives in America. He was working with us, and he told me, like, you got to keep this letter pretty safe. Like, this means a lot. Like, a letter from general, I was like, wow, I'm going to make it. But finally, that process did not work. So I played for a different process, which was the SIV, Special Immigrant Visa. So I got a letter from a major or colonel that I was working for him. And so I was like, I wanted to come to America. Like, I was so happy that, oh, I'm going to go to America. But finally, things completely changed. I was like, well, now I need to go there. Because if I don't go to America, I'm going to be in trouble. Because that was in 2015 when I was, like, really, really serious about coming to America. Because I didn't feel that I'm safe in Afghanistan, especially where I'm from. So I'm from a small village they call Shinwar, but I was not living in the village. I was living in the city. But you know, the ISIS, you know, they call it Daesh. They just emerged from a village. Like, they still have control of the entire district. And people start looking for me, to be honest. I didn't really see someone that he was like, oh, I'm looking for you. But I've started getting this information from my relatives and from my family that I have in village. They were like, well, these people are actually looking for you, and they literally have your name in their hit list. Like, they said, okay, we know that Qismat is not working for the military. That was in 2015, but we believe that he stopped working for them, but we are still going to confiscate the land they have, or the home, whatever property belongs to their family, and they still have it. But then so my relative came to my home, like, well, I think they took over the entire, like, whatever land was left from your grandfather or your father, whatever, like, you can't go there. They have control of your land. They're growing stuff there. They're living in your home right now. And they literally said, like, we cannot give it to him. But if he wants the land and everything, he has to come back to village and talk to us. But I was like, well, that's a trap. Like, no, I'm not going to do it. So that was the time when I was, like, I was so serious and I was scared, to be honest. I could go outside, but, like, every time when I was going outside, I was kind of feeling pretty paranoid. I'm like, wow, something's going to happen to me every single day. And my mom was really worried about me, to be honest. And and my visa was not coming through, which was kind of frustrating. But finally, I mean, I was lucky. Out of nowhere, Matt sent me an email, like, hey, Qismat, how are you? I'm like, I'm good. And he sent me an email. He attached some photos of me and him. He was like, what's going on? You still remember? I'm like, of course, man. Why not? So he was like, why are you still in America, in Afghanistan? I was like, well, I'm still in Afghanistan because I applied for this visa process, but it's not coming through. Those were the day that I start having, like, okay, there's someone actually who's going to help me. And I start, like, I was like, oh, I literally give up. I'm like, I'm not going to make it to America. But those were the days that I start hoping, and things just start going my way.
This is Stanford Legal, and today we're talking with Qismat Amin and Matt Ball about Afghanistan and the United States.
Matt, what do you do when you hear that Qismat is in Afghanistan and you know that ISIS is now taking over? He's under, he's in terrible jeopardy. Let's take it from your perspective.
Sure. So Qismat and I had been in sort of loose contact since I left, especially since I, you know, came back to Afghanistan a couple times. And I don't think I knew sort of when I was in the military that there was much I could do. When I started here as a 1L, people here are encouraged, you know, very strongly to do pro bono projects. So I joined IRAP, the International Refugee Assistance Project. And IRAP does a lot of SIV work, so, you know, just the visa that Qismat was applying for. And so sort of realizing that I had, you know, my interpreter had applied for this, was waiting, I reached back out to Qismat to see if there was anything that I could do to push the process along. And just, you know, sort of for comparison on the process, you know, by statute, it's a process that's supposed to take 18 months. By the time Qismat got to America, I think it had been 4.5 years or so, at least 4 years. So he was well beyond when it should have taken. And the weirdest thing is it was a total black hole for Qismat. So he had no idea if it was because there was a relative that was suspicious or something, you know, security-wise that had tripped things up, or if it just sort of got lost in the pile. Really a complete blackout for information. The one thing that we were sort of told that we could do that would help was file a congressional inquiry, which basically just means a Congress member will ask the State Department, ask the embassy in Kabul, you know, hey, can you look at this case? We're very concerned about so-and-so. So we organized, my 1L year, organized sort of a group of people, both veterans here, people in IRAP, just other sort of concerned citizens here at the law school, basically to come together and write a petition, which we did, And then send that off to everybody's Congress members, since people here, you know, come from all over. So we ended up, I think, contacting something like 32 Congress members. We got, I believe, 13 or 14 congressional inquiries. And, you know, because it's such a blackout, it's hard to know exactly what effect that had. But very quickly, we started seeing movement. So it became pretty apparent that his case sort of got pushed to the top of the pile because so many people were asking about it. And the same thing sort of happened on the press side. So, you know, through IRAP, we sort of reached out to and then did an initial story with the San Francisco Chronicle, again, just to sort of build some momentum so there was some pressure to get Qismat's case resolved. You know, it could have been that what we did was completely ineffective. It could have been that what we did is, you know, what pushed the ball. But finally, last year, so this was, I guess, last December, Qismat was invited to Kabul to complete the last step of the process. And then he arrived here. He was granted his visa in late January of last year, and then got here in early February of 2017.
We'll be back with more from Matt Ball and Qismat Amin talking about Afghanistan and the United States next on Stanford Legal on SiriusXM Insight 121. Welcome back. Welcome back to Stanford Legal, where we look at the cases, questions, conflicts, and legal stories that affect us all every day. I'm Pam Karlan, along with Joe Bankman, and today we're talking with Matt Ball and Qismat Amin about their story in Afghanistan and the United States. And Matt, I want to pick up where we left off right before the break, which was Qismat's arrival in the United States, because I remember you were taking constitutional litigation at the time, and I got an email from you right after the travel ban went into effect, which didn't, it, by its own terms, cover Afghanistan. But you were a little concerned that although by that point Qismat had the papers, he might be kept out of the country. Do you want to pick up there with sort of what happened in those next couple of days? Because I think this is part of what makes the story so extraordinary.
Sure, yeah, so it's crazy because this seems like ancient history right now, but Qismat got his visa, picked it up from the embassy in Kabul the day that the first travel ban was signed, the first executive order. And at that time, if anybody remembers, it wasn't altogether clear what the scope of that ban was. IRAP at the time, I think there was someone who arrived on an SIV visa and was detained. There were sort of rumors that people were being sent back even to Iraq and Afghanistan. The way that it worked on Qismat's end is he could wait 5 months and sort of get a plane ticket. Small footnote is you actually have to pay for your plane ticket if you get granted a refugee visa, which is sort of insane. But he could do that, or if he had sort of the means to, he could buy a plane ticket. So I just bought him a plane ticket because I didn't want to wait 5 months. There was sort of no telling if there was going to be an additional executive order, which, you know, there was, although it didn't cover Qismat when it came out. So we bought him a plane ticket that went through India, I think for like a week from when his visa was granted. And then sort of as you say, Pam, we sent out an email sort of telling everybody what the situation was and then asking people to raise a little bit of money. I think initially we wanted to just cover the cost of his plane ticket. What ended up happening is it really built steam. So we were kind of blown away by what happened eventually. But I think we started a GoFundMe with like a $900 sort of limit on what we wanted and ended up getting, do you remember? Yeah, $25,000, something like that. Just a ridiculous amount of money. And, you know, the irony of ironies here is we sort of benefited from all the sort of hubbub around the first travel ban because everybody was looking for some way to contribute and some way to help. And we're obviously very unlucky in that we had Qismat arriving here at that time, but we were sort of lucky that he presented this sort of thing that you could do about it. The outpouring of sort of community support was really amazing. And Qismat got here, I think on February 8th of that year, and then moved in with me and my wife.
Yeah, I remember one of the things that you had said to me was that you had made an effort to have him fly first touch down in the United States in San Francisco so you could have a lawyer there.
Right.
And we talked about kind of forms to give Qismat ahead of time so that the only thing he was supposed to say to anybody when he landed is, I want to see my lawyer, I want to see my lawyer. And you sent me this photo from the arrival. You all were there at, what, about 7 in the morning. Yep. It was the most moving photo to see. I guess an elementary school had done a huge sign that said, "Welcome home." And there were a whole bunch of law students there, and there were some old ladies. I'm not sure who the old ladies in the photo you sent me were.
I
older
also
even
don't know.
Than I.
Yeah.
But it was just incredibly moving to see all these law students who had showed up at SFO in the morning, and you had a lawyer there in case Qismat needed a lawyer who could go in and see him. Just an extraordinary event.
Yeah, and I should say, I'm glad you brought that up. I am also leaving out, we did get help from professors here, immigration law professors, essentially to act as our attorney, Qismat's attorney, or put him in touch with attorneys at the airport so his sort of arrival would go smoothly.
Qismat, I'd like to now pick up your side of the story. You're in America now, and you land on the plane, mm-hmm. and we were all very moved by that photo. What are you thinking at the time?
I mean, I'm kind of like, to be honest, that when I, like the first day that when I got my visa, it was kind of overwhelming because I was waiting for 3 years and finally it happened. And I was like, oh, I can't believe it. I can't believe it. Yeah. So from the time that I got my visa, I mean, and like when I looked at the news the same day that I picked up my visa and the news were saying that there's a banning order, you know, nobody can go to America, especially if you're Muslim or also if you're an immigrant. So I was like, well, it's going to be hard to go to America. But honestly, I was pretty sure that Stanford, you know, math and everything kind of made me so motivated and so hopeful that I thought that even if someone stopped me in the airport, I know that I get a lot of support because Matt told me that this is the form, like he sent me the form before I was coming to the United States, and he told me that if something happens, you just tell the cop or the whoever stops you, just get talk with this person. And I was kind of, to be honest, I was kind of very hopeful, like I was very happy that, you know, somebody's going to be there and Matt's going to be there with people outside of airport, and if something happens, so he's going to support me, he's going to get me out of there. So I was so happy. But yeah, when I came to the United States, I'm like, right now it's so overwhelming, to be honest. Like, everything you see here is completely different in Afghanistan, and especially in Silicon Valley. Like, you see a lot of tech companies, and like, I work at Tesla right now, and people don't even believe that I work at Tesla. I can't even believe it, to be honest. I'm like, do I really work at Tesla or not? Especially when I'm wearing that jacket and go outside and pick up food somewhere, and people are like, oh, you work at Tesla? I'm like, yeah, I work at Tesla. So it's, everything's overwhelming, to be honest. Like, I feel really good, and especially in this area. I've learned so much from the people, and kind of like motivates me to do more and more. Like we talked before the show, that you asked me what you want to be. Like, I want to be a boss of myself, because in this area, I see a lot of people have their own startup company, they have their own business, and which is the beauty of this area, and it really kind of drags me toward that. I want to do something more, and I'm so happy, to be honest.
This is Stanford Legal, and today we're talking with Qismat Amin and Matt Ball about their lives in Afghanistan and then in the United States.
We were talking before the break about your desire to become an entrepreneur yourself, and of course, I'm tempted to right now make you pledge that you're only going to hire Stanford law grads to represent you when you're forming, when you're going public, when you're doing, et cetera, et cetera. But take us a little bit, Qismat, to what's it like living with Matt and his wife? That must be, everything must be odd, but what was that like?
I mean, that was such an amazing feeling. I mean, Matt is just like, honestly, he's my family now. When I came to the United States, I lived at his house for almost 6 months, and I had such a good time with him, like literally eating on the same table, talking to him, and finally I started knowing his parents, you know, his wife's parents, and all his friends, like his friends from Stanford, like family friends, and now everyone knows me, so I feel like Matt is my family here. And it was such an amazing feeling. Like the first day when I came here, the next day we came to Stanford. I heard a lot about Stanford when I was in Afghanistan, to be honest, because people say, oh, Stanford, you know, one of the best schools in America. And when I actually came to Stanford, and I thought, like, I should take a pictures, you know, like put it on my Facebook or something, like, oh, I'm at Stanford right now. Finally, I mean, made everything so easy for me, because I always say, I'm going to say this, that I'm very lucky to be here, like very, very lucky. I can't even think about it, to be honest, and I'm not gonna take it for granted, because I'm like, I know everybody at Stanford. I come to Stanford, I talk to these wonderful people here, I go outside, and math kind of taught me a lot of things that probably I couldn't end up in a really bad place, but he told me, like, you have to stick in this area, learn as much as you can, and try to find a better job, and I think you can do more. I mean, right now I have a job at Tesla. I think that I got a job at Tesla probably, like, I had an interview and everything, I qualified, but I think the credit goes to math, because he kind of motivated me to stay in this area and learn as much as you can. And working on Tesla, to be honest, like, I see a lot of, literally every person is American. They're all students from Santa Clara or from different university, but I never been to any school here in America, but I still work there, and I'm doing probably better than other students, and I think that's amazing.
Can you, we're almost out of time. I'm wondering, you speak so many languages, you're a translator. Some of us have had trouble learning one language. That's me. I have trouble with my S's and R's.
Okay.
Could you say something to us to kind of close it in your native language, which would be Pashto?
Say something in Pashto?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I can say a lot of things in Pashto. Yeah. Dear banana, as a dear banana come to Stanford to Shagadana, or to the Stanford Kum Professor Andy, or the Pulmod Gedi Matna. So I said thanks for all the Stanford students, and thanks from you both professors, and also my buddy Matt. That was a Pashto, but if I wanted to say in Dari, like, Tashakur Azamitan, Tashakur Az Professor, Tashakur Az Rafiki Matt both. So it's like thanks from all the Stanford students, from you both wonderful professors, and my buddy Matt. So that was in there. Yeah.
I understood the Matt Ball.
Yeah.
So thank you so much for joining us on Stanford Legal here on SiriusXM Insight 121.
All right.
So if folks have any questions for Matt or Qismat, yeah, feel free to ask them. Yeah. Can you do it from the mic, though, just because that way if we're for the taping and stuff.
No problem. First of all, thank you so much for letting us sit in on this absolutely incredible story. Thank you both to both of you for your service, for everything. I know that's cliche, but it gets unsaid too often. So what I wanted to ask you is, personally, what did you take away from the war in Afghanistan? I mean, obviously, it's an incredible story, something both of you will never forget. And then as future lawyers, as future policymakers, what lessons should we be taking from the war in Afghanistan?
Oof, geez. I feel like I could write a book on that. So I guess to your first question, I think for me, there's a lot of lessons to draw on from Afghanistan. I think I draw different personal lessons than I do maybe policy lessons. I spent like 2 years of my life or so in Afghanistan. And so I think I retain like sort of a big emotional connection to the place. Some of that's sort of sad, not just for sort of soldiers that I lost there, but also because, the area that Qismat and I were in, we had a ton of success. By the time that we left Afghanistan, the area that we controlled looked much different than it did when we got there. And we felt like we had done a lot of good. I think the sad part now is that the effects of that are probably a wash. You know, since then we left, basically when my unit left, nobody replaced us. And so the lasting success of that, I think, is just sad for me personally when it's contrasted with sort of the lives and the resources that went into it. Politically, I think we'll kind of be grappling with it for a long time. But maybe the one thing I would say about that is, I think, and maybe this gets to your second question about what you can draw from it as attorneys, I think the thing that strikes me a lot about Afghanistan is the sort of the mismatch between how much the general population has felt the war, and this is true for the war in Iraq as well, versus sort of the amount of kind of foreign policy, political capital that we spent there. And so I think as an attorney, something that, I think about, well, I'm not an attorney yet, but something I will think about, something you all will think about, I think it's very important, even constitutionally, that we take war very seriously, And I think there's a reason why war is supposed to be a very difficult thing to do. And I think the reason is because you want the entire population to really feel the burden when you go to war so that we take that decision with its proper weight. And so I think now, after sort of spending 3 years here in law school, where I've arrived at is thinking, you know, of ways to how we can match the weight of what should be the decision to go to war with sort of the mechanism that we do so as a country.
Other questions?
I would love to hear from all four of you, but especially you two, about what you would recommend for policy changes to the refugee resettlement process or the visa process, especially on transparency.
Thank you. All right, so yeah, the refugee process. So the refugee process, if there's a certain, like, let's say, requirements and a procedure that you have to go through, or like a vetting process or something, so there should be some, like, justice in the process, because as far as I know, like, I've seen people, they apply for their visa just like me. I applied for my visa for, three years. Like, I waited for 3 years or almost 4 years, and I've seen people being waiting more than 4 to 5 years. And there should be some sort of, like, way of actually you should know why your visa in the hole, like, or you should provide information. Let's say if I'm sending you an email, you're the embassy, or you're the guy that who approves the visa, or so you should tell me, like, what is the hold? Because I don't see that. You never get that answer. And also, if there's a certain requirement, if you can meet the requirement, I mean, you just should get your visa. Just like for a Stanford school. When you come to Stanford school, I'm sure there's some sort of test that you have to take, and you should provide some sort of documents or whatever it is. So exactly the same thing. And every process has to be some sort of procedure that you have to meet the requirement, and then finally you're like, okay, I met the requirement. Now I should get my visa. There shouldn't be, there shouldn't be anything that can hold me back without, not getting my visa. So that's what I see in the process.
I would say three things. I think the first is the process could just be much smarter. As you mentioned, there's zero transparency, which would help out a lot of people. Even things like we provide actually very little help once people already get here. So Qismat was sort of lucky enough to get here and have a community. But really what ends up happening is people get here and they just call up the people they know who've already been here. So there's a huge Afghan community in Sacramento, for instance. And basically, almost every Afghan immigrant who arrives in America gets placed somewhere random, arrive in like South Dakota or Mississippi, call up their friends and they say, we're all in Sacramento, come over here. And that's the support system. There's no support that we actually give towards refugees who arrive. So that can work if there's a community. It doesn't work if there's not. And I think that's a gap that we need to bridge. The second is just on the numbers game. SIV recipients like Qismat should not be a politically contentious issue at all. I don't think refugees should be a contentious issue, period. But I think if anything's going to be an issue, it certainly shouldn't be people who've like risk their lives, served alongside American soldiers. So vetting, quote unquote, you know, if you haven't vetted yourself by like returning fire next to Americans for, you know, 3 or 4 years, I don't think you're going to get more vetting by virtue of like the Department of Agriculture checking into your background. I think SIV should be, if you qualify, you get here. It's not a capped program. It's something that you earn. It's a debt that we repay to people. And then lastly, I would say just for refugees in general, and this isn't Qismat necessarily, but refugees are, nobody's really talking about refugees right now. We're talking about refugees as sort of a political proxy to talk about other issues of American identity. And I think what that loses sight of is these are humans. These are actual people. Yeah. For the most part, they're fleeing conflict. They're fleeing war. Nobody who's ever met Qismat could, with a straight face, say that they're worried about like the security implications of letting people in. But nobody's really talking about the people. And I know that's sort of a vague recommendation that we should do that, but it is important that we don't lose sight of that.
Yeah, I want to add something real quick to this. But I mean, like my brother, who was also you also worked for the U.S. military as an interpreter. So he applied for the SIV process, right, for the Special Immigrant Visa process. So what happened, he got approval, everything. He went to the embassy, had an interview, and after interview was actually waiting for his visa. And his process got canceled, like his visa pretty much got canceled. And the reason that we were asking the embassy, like, why his visa got canceled, like, why the process got canceled, because it was approved at the beginning, and he went to get an interview, and everything's fine, and he's clear. Why you guys canceled his process, or shut down his process? He was like, well, he was language failed, so he worked for 1.5 years, and then there was some sort of process that you should, again, take a test of language, make sure you're an interpreter, you're translating everything correctly. So for some reason, he didn't pass the test. So it doesn't mean that if he did not pass the test, he's not qualified to come to the U.S. Because when the SIV came up, so the reason of the SIV was to actually, because these interpreters who are in Afghanistan or they work for the military, their life is actually in risk, in danger. So they want to come to the U.S. so they can have free life, right? So can come out of the risk. And so my brother is still stuck. And so if he wants to apply again, he has to work for 2 years. So the rule's been changed. So he applied under the rule of 1 year. So you were supposed to work only for 1 year. So now he can appeal. But even if he wants to appeal, he can't appeal because he's not working right now. He only worked 1.5 years. So that's kind of like very frustrating, actually.
So thank you both very much for coming in on a Sunday. And we're going to move now to taping our other show. And it turns out there's a kind of, you know, there's that cliche about the law being a seamless web. And you work at Tesla, and one of our guests on the next show drives a Tesla. And we're actually going to talk a little bit about Loomis, which is a case that Matt worked on in the Supreme Court Litigation Clinic as part of our discussion of stuff in a moment. So we'll take maybe a 2 or 3 minute break and set up again, and then we'll do the second taping.
Artificial intelligence.